Will I start now? Can you hear me? Hello? Hello? Doctor, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, now then I can start now. Doctor, today our discussion is on twin and ectopic pregnancy. First, I will discuss on twin pregnancy. You all know that about 2-3% incidence of twin is there. So, naturally, twin and multiple pregnancy, of course, by 3,000, by 3,001 triplet or quadruplet. So, we'll mainly concentrate on twin, doctor. Mainly concentrate on twin, but during your examination, you can get triplet and quadruplet. Rarely, you can get triplet or quadruplet also. So, Let us start our discussion on twin. Today is our lockdown, so we have very limited staff today. Okay, there's no problem. We'll start it. So you all know that zygote formed by fertilization of ova and the sperm, and if there is two ova fertilized by two sperm, then it will be a dizygotic twin. But sometimes it also happens the one zygote divides. If the one zygote divides within three days, it also becomes a twin. And it may be divided after 3 days also, 4 to 5 days also. I'll come to monozygotic and dizygotic twin, and monozygotic and monopolyonic and monoamniotic, monopolyonic and diamniotic, dipolyonic, diamniotic. All these twin I gradually come. First of all, you will have to know that the two zygotes, when the two zygotes separately fertilized by two sperm, it becomes a twin and it is a dizygotic twin. So, zygosity and twinicity will have to determine. So, now let us come to the point. So, if two ova comes and there is fertilization separately by two sperm, so naturally there will be twin pregnancy, and it will get dichorionic and diamniotic twin. But sometimes it also happens within 3 days, that is the blastocyst within 3 days, if it is divides, and there will be completely two chorion and two amnion. So it looks like a dizygotic twin, but a monozygotic twin also behave like dizygotic and dichorionic and diamniotic twin. But if the division occurs within 3 to 4 days, into 3 to 4 days, a monozygotic twin may be monopolyonic diamniotic twin. So, and sometimes it also may be dichorionic and diamniotic twin. But if the zygote, if the zygote divides after 8 days, it becomes monopolionic. It becomes monopolionic, monoapolionic twin. So that is the most complicated, dangerous type of twin. Monocardial polionic, monoapolitic twin. Then after 13 days, if there is any division occurs, so there will be conjoined twins. So naturally this different type of twins we'll have to, by sonography, we'll have to, like this. Well, okay. So you have understood how the periodicity and abnormality can be defined and how, what is the internal pathology, how it occurs. Then your morbidity and mortality. So in case of twin, the morbidity and mortality is very high for maternal mortality, and the infant mortality is very high. So what happens during your in case of twin, there are many type of complication may occur in case of twin. So first of all, there may be placenta previa, there may be abruptio placenti, there may be congenital malformation, there may be polyhydramnios, there may be anemia, there may be preeclampsia, there may be postpartum hemorrhage, and there may be precipitated labor. So all these conditions may cause maternal mortality or fetal mortality. So this is for that reason, the maternal mortality and fetal mortality is very high in case of twin. So, among these twin, monocardionic and monoapolitic twin is most mortality, and the complication is more in case of monocardionic and monoapolitic twin. Monocardionic and monoapolitic twin is most complicated twin among these, but dizygotic twin is most simply dizygotic twin. So how the sonographic determination of the periodicity and abnormality? First of all, in the first trimester pregnancy, when you will see the two gestational sac. If you can see the two gestational sac and two embryo with two gestational sac, it is divided. It is in two separate gestational sac in two embryos with two cardiac pulsation. If you can see, so naturally it is definitely dizygotic twin. So you are seeing two gestational sac. You are seeing two fetal pole with cardiac pulsation. But if you see one gestational sac with two fetal pole with one gestational sac, naturally naturally, you will have to think that it may be a piece of one placental mass. One placental mass, then you will have to see, think that it is a piece of monochorionic, monoamniotic twin. So, but in case of early pregnancy, if you cannot see that it is difficult, sometimes it is difficult to see the separating membrane, this pseudo separating membrane. So naturally, by ultrasound, if you can't see the two separating membrane, you may have to perform transvaginal ultrasound. But in our program, we are doing the transvaginal ultrasound, so we'll have to wait for second trimester pregnancy. In the second trimester pregnancy, you can see two placental mass. If you can see the two placental mass with two gestational sac, naturally it's a dynamic diabetic twin. But if you see only one placental mass with one gestational sac, may be divided into two separate sacs. So that may be a case of monochorionic diabetic twin. And particularly in this type of cases, monochorionic diabetic twin, there you can see a twin peak sign means that both the placenta, they join together, and with the membrane, there is a twin peak, or which is called lambda sign. So if you get twin peak or lambda sign, so naturally there is two placenta and two amniotic cavity. So it is a case of dichorionic diabetic twin. And another sign you can see the separating membrane. If the separating membrane is thick, so there is one compartment. There is two membranes. One is chorion and another is amnion. So for two sacs, there will be four membranes. So if there is four membranes come together, so naturally it will be a thick membrane. So if the separating membrane is thick, so we can say that is a diabetic and dichorionic twin. So and sometimes also if there is, so in early pregnancy also we can see the yolk sac also. If we see the yolk sac, two yolk sac, so naturally we have to think that there will be dichorionic twin. So like that we have to go in the early pregnancy, but it is better to see the chorionicity and amniocity in the second trimester pregnancy, where you can easily see both the chorion, both the placenta and both the sac. So you can diagnose the chorion, and it is very important to diagnose the chorionicity and amniocity accurately in the beginning, that chorionic monoamniotic twin is the most bad type of twin. So there may be complications. Monoamniotic and monochorionic twin, they will be admitted at one. There will be complication. So now let us come to the next point. I already told you about the maternal mortality and the fetal mortality for that in case of twin. Why there is fetal and maternal mortality and amniocity? Sometimes the amniocentesis may require into diagnose the chromosome. I already told you that one of the complications of the twin is your congenital anomalies. So for congenital anomalies, some chromosomal study Apple, only one stat is required. For that reason, you have to amniocentesis is also required. For amniocentesis, what you have to do, you have to take the fluid, you have to take the amniotic fluid from one sac. Then again, you have to put some dye in the sac. So that in the same sac, you don't take fluid from the same sac again. So you can take, you can examine that fluid for chromosomal study of the separate twin, whether they are eating congenital anomaly or not. So sometimes in the first trimester twin, so what happens first trimester twin? So one twin may demise. One fetus or one embryo may demise. So and the other embryo it grows, other embryo grows. So naturally, when one embryo becomes blinded, so other embryo it grows. So when it grows, it compresses the empty gestational sac. So in second time, in after 2 to 3 weeks, when we examine that mother, you can't see the second gestational sac. So, which is called vanishing twin. So, in case of first trimester pregnancy, very early stage, you may see the both the sac, but in after 2 to 3 weeks, you may not see the other sac. So, which is called vanishing twin. So when you declare twin, so you will have to wait for another 2 to 3 weeks. So after 2 to 3 weeks, you declare that it is a teacher twin, not before that. Since after second examination, you declare that it is a teacher twin. So now in the second trimester, so your chorionicity and amniocentesis you will have to check it. You'll have to check whether it's a monochorionic or dichorionic. Or more amniotic or diabetic, you have to check it. And secondly, another thing, in second trimester, sometimes what happens, there may be IUFD of one fetus. So, but other fetus it grows normally. Other fetus grows normally. So, which one is the IUFD becomes IUFD? So, it becomes lacerated and due to the gravity. Due to the gravity, it comes towards the internal loss. So, towards the internal loss, and it becomes lacerated, and lacerated. So, what that lacerated fetus, lacerated internal, lacerated fetus in one fetus, which is called papyraceous fetus. Capillaceous fetus and that may sometimes be some complication which involves some embolism, some complication which is called that twin embolism syndrome. That dead fetus, that papyraceous fetus, may cause twin embolism syndrome. And this may occur in case of second trimester pregnancy. In third trimester, so this is one of the complications of the dead twin. Next, there may be sometimes a Aquarian parabolic twin. Aquarian parabolic twin also may occur. Sometimes I already told you, sometimes conjoined twin also occur. Sometimes there may be heterotrophic twin also occur. Heterotrophic twin means what happens, that heterotrophic multiple gestation, what happens, that one pregnancy is in the uterine cavity. In the uterine cavity, another pregnancy is in the ectopic, that is outside the uterine cavity. So that also will make the seat maybe walk out. And sometimes in case of multiple gestation, that is diplet or quadriplet. So we have to perform the selective deduction of the fetus. For selective deduction of the fetus, we may require some laser, short laser, or some laser ablation, or sometimes some fluid, some ultrasound guided to the injectable to the cardiac injection to just cardiac to the heart to make it stop the heart. This reduction of the selective deduction is also done by ultrasound intervention. You can do the selective reduction of this. And one thing that when we perform the ultrasound, which fetus is closer to the internal os, we say either A1 or A2A, or it is away from the internal os, we call this twin B. So, and that sometimes another point that is when there is 3 or 4 quadruplets or triplet. So from the left side we come anti-clockwise, we come A, B, C, like that. From left side we come to the inverse A, B, C. So these two methods we generally apply for your naming or which one is the twin one or which one is the twin two. For this thing we have to leave this way. Next is your subject. When we perform this, we calculate the gestationally. For example, fetus 1, then we have to see the pleural length, head, the DPD, inner DPD, head circumference, and abdominal circumference, and we calculate the gestational age. In that way, fetus 1 and fetus 2 also we have to do. And naturally, the weight of the fetus and gestational age is slightly different, not really the same. Though the date of fertilization is the same, but it will be different. So, if the weight of one fetus is about the less than 25% of the other fetus, so we say that is IVF. That fetus is IVF. So if the weight is when one fetus weight, another fetus weight is less than 25% of the first fetus or fetus A or fetus B, we say that is IVF. So that is also we have to calculate whether there is IVF or not. And then we'll have to see We'll have to examine both the fetus. And we'll have to see whether there is any congenital anomaly or not. That is also we'll have to examine the congenital anomaly or not. So this is the general examination. So then, in case of monozygotic, monopolyotic, and monoamniotic twin. There are one complication with that one placenta it supplies blood to both the fetus. So when you supply with both the fetus, when I discuss with you the placenta, I told you that there is the anastomosis. That is the arterial anastomosis, venous anastomosis, and arterial venous anastomosis. So, when there is arterial venous anastomosis, the one fetus gets more blood circulation. And when there is more blood circulation, So naturally, there is hypervolumemia. So more blood circulation is there. So there is congestive cardiac failure. In what is? And if the congestive cardiac failure is there, so what will happen? There will be ascites, there will be dual efficient, there will be pedic and efficient, there will be hydroxyphthalates, so on, there will be hydroxyphthalates with that congestive cardiac failure. So another fetus, and there will be polyhydroxy, there is the sand. There will be much fluid also there. And the another fetus, it will be in late circulation, and it will be, if their abdominal circumference will be less, and it will be IUTI. So this condition, which is called the twin-to-twin transmission syndrome. So this is the one of the important complications of monozygotic, monochorionic, and monoamplitic twin. In case of monozygotic twin, this is one of the complications. About 3% of the monozygotic twin, it gives this type of complication. So you are this type of complication. So naturally, this type of complication will get. So you have understood
how to diagnose twin, what are the complications of twin, how to diagnose the chorionicity and amniocity of the twin. I hope you have understood. So now I just repeat you again. The important things, I'm repeating you again, important thing. Most important thing is to diagnose by your sonologist, most important thing diagnose is the chorionicity and amniocity. And because dichorionic diamnetic twin is the most safest twin. But monochorionic, monoamniotic is not safe, then there is complication. So if we diagnose very early at this stage, which one is the dichorionic diamnetic and which one is the monochorionic monoamniotic twin, so it will be helpful to manage the twin by the gynecologist. So it is our duty to diagnose. Basically, one thing I would like to tell you, doctor, basically, that when you examine a pregnant woman or fetal placental profile, you have to act that from the very beginning. From the very beginning, you see the abdominal height. If the abdominal height is not tally with your gestational age calculated by LFP, you have to think three things. Number one is polyhydramnios, number two is twin, and number three is long day. So naturally from the very beginning, if you have in your mind that it may be a case of twin, so you will not miss twin. This is one thing. Another thing, when you put your transducer over the abdomen, if you put your transducer, if you see too many fetal parts, then you have to suspect it may be a case of twin. And thirdly, for all fetal profile cases, you, after completion of your examination, you make a survey throughout the abdomen, just using your transducer throughout the abdomen to see whether you are missing any head. So sometimes what happens? One fetus may be your big presentation, another fetus may be in the cephalic presentation. So you are examining the cephalic fetus with cephalic presentation. But if you don't see the other one corner of the abdomen, you will miss another head. So these three things, if you keep it in your mind, if these three things, then you will not miss it. Missing that all the patient, is it very easy to diagnose twin in the first trimester or in the second trimester pregnancy. But sometimes if the patient comes in the third trimester, you may miss the twin. So for that reason, this three rule, you always follow these three rules, height of the abdomen, if you don't tell you your gestational age calculated by LMP, then you have to think whether it's a case of polyhydramnios or the case of twin or the case of long day. And then this is first thing, first before recognition. Then you put your transition, if there is too many parts, too many fetal parts, then and thirdly, you, after completion of the examination, you examine whole of the abdomen, to see whether there is another head or not. So in that way, you go on examination of the twin, and initially I told you to determine the coriolicity and abdominicity of the twin, you have to determine. And the complication already I told you, and I told you that if you can diagnose twin in early stage, twin in coriolicity and abdominicity of twin, that will be very much helpful for that gynecologist. And the congenital or conjoint twin, I told you, Acadia, Fidelity, Acadia, I told you, and this all these things I told you, and your maternal mortality, and maternal mortality, and infidel mortality, I told you, complication of the twin, I told you. So if you have, now I go to the next part of our discussion, that is the ectopic pregnancy. So if you have any question, on twin, you can ask me, doctor. If you have any question, you can ask me. Any question, doctor? Regarding twin, any question?
Hello?
Please, yes, I hear you.
Can you repeat the diagnosis of chorionicity and abdominicity?
Okay, doctor. But starting from the first trimester pregnancy, if you see two embryo with two cardiac pulsation, so you have to think that it may be a case of, you have to see separating membrane. If you can see the separating membrane, then you can tell this is 16 dichorionic diatomic twin. But if you cannot see the separating membrane, only the two embryo, then you wait for a few weeks, after a few weeks you can see two placental mass. If you can see the two placental mass with two viable embryo and one separating membrane, because it has four layers, one chorion, one amnion from one sac, and another chorion and another amnion from another sac. So the four layers, that is thick layer with two placental mass, then it is being confirmed, it can confirm it, say that it is a dichorionic diamnionic twin. And if you cannot see the gestational sac, the separating membrane, and only two embryo in one sac, and one placental mass, so naturally you'll have to diagnose that it is a case of monochorionic, monoamniotic twin. And another Another clue, particularly in case of second diameter pregnancy, if you can see the lambda sign or twin peak sign, when the two chorion, that's two placenta join together, it forms a twin peak sign or lambda sign. So naturally, you can by seeing that lambda sign or twin peak sign, you can diagnose that it is a dichorionic diamniotic twin. So you will have to, and naturally when the third diameter pregnancy, if you see, that is easy to see two placenta. If you can see two both the placenta, so naturally it is a dichorionic, but in that case the separating membrane is difficult to set the separating membrane. So mainly you have to see the two placenta mass in the early pregnancy, in the first diameter pregnancy or early second diameter pregnancy, or twin peak or lambda sign in the second diameter pregnancy, and third diameter pregnancy two placenta separately, then it is confirmed that it's a case of dichorionic diamniotic twin. But if you see only single placenta with single amniotic cavity, so naturally you will have to see in the case of monochorionic monoamniotic twin. Are you clear, doctor?
Yes, sir.
Can you
yes,
hear
sir.
Me? So mainly you will have to look for the placenta. Any other question, doctor? Those who are attending this, tell me. Okay. One thing, first of all, dizygotic, sometimes the monozygotic twin also, if it divides within three days, if a monozygotic twin divides, that is the blastocyst, it divides within 3 days, it is same like dizygotic twin, so dichorionic diamniotic twin. So early division, if the blastocyst divides very early within 3 days, then we cannot differentiate monozygotic or dizygotic. Both are dichorionic diamniotic, both are. But after 3 days when it divides, so then it becomes monochorionic diamniotic twin. Is it clear to you, doctor? Is it clear? Dr. Mukesh? If that twin is dichorionic, so they go up. No complication. Dichorionic twin, dichorionic and diamniotic twin is the most simplest twin. So you may not worry. Only the worrying part is the homochorionic, monoamniotic twin. So we are not going to diversity. Diversity is one thing. Dizygote or whole single zygote also divide, if it divides within 3 days, it feels like dizygotic twin. So there is no harm in it, doctor. So I think I am a little bit clear, so you'll have to read the book, make a little bit list of the things you can understand. So now I like to go to my second part of discussion is the ectopic pregnancy. So doctor, now the advancement of the science and technology, we have less maternal mortality than previously. Previously there are more maternal mortality in case of ectopic pregnancy. But now the diagnostic facilities is more. That is, this is more at very early start, even in the early stage, we can diagnose the with the ectopic pregnancy, that is the ectopic pregnancy and proper measures, or proper management can be done, so that naturally the there is complication, less complication of the mortality rate is less. But doctor, but the incidence of ectopic pregnancy is rising. Incidence of ectopic pregnancy is rising. Why the incidence of ectopic pregnancy is rising? First of all, the if that the history of ectopic pregnancy, then again, the she or she may have ectopic pregnancy. Sometimes for the intrauterine contraceptive device for your family planning affairs, some women use intrauterine contraceptive device, so that may initiate the ectopic pregnancy, and the infection, the pelvic inflammatory disease. Pelvic inflammatory disease, which may cause scarring of the tube, so that also cause the tubal pregnancy. That may also cause the tubal pregnancy. Next is your ectopic pregnancy. Next is your tubal reconstruction surgery. Even tubal reconstruction surgery also may cause the ectopic pregnancy. Next is your sometimes intrauterine, that is IVF, in vitro fertilization. They are putting the embryo, the egg inside the uterus, and there may be ectopic pregnancy. And sometimes there may be the laparoscopic tubal reconstruction. Also, coagulation also may cause. So, all these conditions, there in this incidence of the ectopic pregnancy is increasing. Incidence of ectopic pregnancy is increasing. So, next point is how to diagnose clinical pathological findings. First of all, the pathological findings of the ectopic pregnancy. Pathological findings, first of all, of course, there will be history of amenorrhea. Patient will come with history of amenorrhea, and the uterus is slightly enlarged inside, but there is no gestational sac. Only you can see some amount of fluid in the uterine cavity, and there may be a sac-like structure which we call pseudo gestational sac. And it is in the central part of the uterus, that is not eccentric, that is in the uterine cavity. In the uterine cavity, you get some little bit of fluid. Along with the fluid, you will get a hypertrophy of the endometrial cavity, and it looks like what we call pseudo gestational sac. But In the adnexal region, you may get a sac-like substance in the adnexal region, and naturally, and in that adnexal region, even there may be some residual reaction also, and even you may get some embryo within the sac. So the pregnancy is not in the uterine cavity, but in the outside uterine cavity. But if the pregnancy is up to 8 weeks, the fetus the embryo grows up to 8 inches within the tube. Within the tube, then it may grow up to 8 inches, but after 8 weeks, it may not grow, and then it will be rupture of the tube. So what happens? What happens within 8 weeks, if you examine, you can see an excel mass within the gestational sac with some tube. If you are lucky, you can see the embryo also. You can observe the embryo also, but after 8 weeks, there will be rupture of the tube. When there is rupture of the tube, there will be heterogeneous mass in the adnexal linea, and in the pouch of Douglas, you will get some fluid, that is blood, in the pouch of Douglas, and there will be hemoperitoneum. When there is hemoperitoneum, naturally, you may get some fluid in the hepatorenal space. So this is your pathological condition in case of early pregnancy, early ectopic pregnancy after, even before and after of the ectopic pregnancy. But sometimes what happens in case of very early pregnancy, You may not get any adnexal mass, or you may not get in the sac also. So in that case, if the urine test is positive, you are not getting any gestational sac in the uterine cavity, you are not getting any adnexal mass, then what you will do? So you have to perform the syrup, human chorionic gonadotropin destination, level of this syrup, human chorionic gonadotropin, and serial examination. And if it rises, your normally it is about 6,000 international unit, and if it rises, then you have to think for ectopic pregnancy. But if it declines, then you may not think for ectopic pregnancy. So serum human chorionic gonadotropin level is very important. Serum chorionic gonadotropin level. So another thing, that in case of the rupture of the ectopic pregnancy, or in case of clinical evaluation, the signs and symptoms mainly your pain. Small amount of fluid perianal bleeding, and severe shock patient come to you. And nowadays, of course, fluorescence is not done, but because it was done, and you will get the blood and fluorescence disease, and pregnancy test will be also positive. Sonographic interpretation, I already told you the uterus will be slightly bulky, and there will be no gestational sac, and there may be some gestational sac, and adnexal linea, you get the mass in the adnexal linea, and there will be hemoperitoneum. So, and this is the normally ectopic pregnancy is in the tubal linea. So, it is the tubal linea, and this condition is about 95% in the tube, and is 95% you will get in the tubal region, that it will be pregnancy. But there are another 5%, so ambulary and the ismus, mainly the ambulary region as we have about, and is remaining to be pregnancy in the ambulary region of the tube, but that will be the ismus region also, you may get sometimes. But there are another 5% we get in the another abnormal condition, other condition we may get, like your interstitial, that is there, the tube interstitial level 2 to 5%, in the cervical region level 1 to 2%, and the tubal region, in the ovarian region level 1 to 1%, and the pineal level 1%. So this is the another abnormal condition the pituitary, ovary, the interstitial cordon, and the cervical region. These 5% is separated. So in that context, when there is the interstitial region, if there is any weakness in the interstitial location, and there may be it gives some space, more space. I don't think in that tube, after it takes, it may be get the space, but after it takes, it will rupture. But in the interstitial region, it is the space is more. So naturally the fetus grow more. So that is it little bit late space, it rupture. So about 15 to 16 minutes it ruptures, and then there's profuse breathing. So interstitial pregnancy is very dangerous, and then profuse breathing in the interstitial state. Next is the cervical one, cervical region also, we may get the sac in the cervical region and the brown in cervical region. And if it grows, it is also the point that it's ruptured, that the painless breathing and the white pattern by your BPA definition, it's a double separate structure, you may get in a double separate structure. Next is your very rare is your abdominal ectopic pregnancy. When the tubal ruptures, the embryo implanted, the embryo implanted in the broad ligament, and there may be the pregnancy grows there, and it's very rare, of course, in the abdominal ectopic pregnancy, and in that case, it's very difficult to separate the placenta, even after cesarean section, very difficult to separate the placenta, and so you keep the placenta there and it comes out. So these are the different sites of the abnormal, these are the separate sites of the abnormal anterior location of the ectopic pregnancy, anterior location of the ectopic pregnancy. And another, nowadays we apply Doppler. Even that to diagnose the ectopic pregnancy, we apply Doppler. So naturally Doppler, it looks like a fireball appearance surrounding the tissue solar sac in the adnexal region. It gives a blood color, so rounds blood like a fireball. It gives a color like fireball. So it is also a Doppler confirmation of the ectopic pregnancy. So I hope, doctor, that another thing is old ectopic pregnancy. Old ectopic pregnancy, sometimes in the tubal pregnancy, the embryo divides. Due to some abnormal blood circulation or other, that embryo divides, and there will be heterogeneous mass. There may be heterogeneous mass in the tubal region, and patient is in dilating pain, there is no rupture, and there is no rupture. So there may be dilating pain, and urine test is positive, naturally urine test is positive and dilating pain. This type of patient sometimes is diagnosed. Misdiagnosis at tumor, so that is also you have to keep you, you should be alive, it is a dictum that all women in your fertility age group 32 if she complains of pain abdomen. Woman within the fertility age group, if she complains of pain abdomen, so first of all, you have to think ectopic, and you have to examine the urine for pregnancy test. This is a big thing. A woman complaining of pain abdomen, having some adnexal mass, in the fertility age group. So you just ask the patient or you examine the patient, you have urine for pregnancy test. So if it is an old ectopic pregnancy, you will not miss it. You will not miss it, the old ectopic pregnancy, you will not miss it. And of course, the treatment is conservative. So that treatment is conservative, so you will miss it. But our task is to diagnose. So if we can diagnose that in the case of old ectopic, then the doctor will be happy. So this is all about ectopic pregnancy, doctor, and I think that he will not miss the ectopic. Young woman with a good married young woman, or sometimes the unmarried woman also come to you with a good pain in your abdomen. Then if needed, you examine the urine, and if you suspect ectopic, you examine the urine, you should have a kit with you also. And ask the patient to bring in the urine and you see with the urine outside, you just see whether the urine is positive or not. So keep always in your mind that it may be a case of ectopic pregnancy. So naturally sometimes patient may come without examination of the urine. Only pain abdomen with a bleeding PP. So in that case also you'll have to think for in case of ectopic pregnancy, and you'll have to examine the urine. You'll have to examine the urine for pregnancy test. So in that way, doctor, you have to diagnose the ectopic pregnancy, and I hope you will not miss ectopic. And if you follow this technique, it will be easier for you. And always examine the patient. I told you that female pelvis. Always examine the female pelvis in full bladder. But then you will not miss any that you will not miss any rather adnexal mass. And another important diagnostic procedure is that if you suspect ruptured ectopic, always you examine the hepatorenal space. And if there is blood or fluid in the hepatorenal space, then you are confirmed that it is a case of ectopic pregnancy, ruptured ectopic pregnancy. So in that way you proceed, and I hope you will not miss ectopic pregnancy. So, doctor, if you have any question, you can ask me regarding the ectopic pregnancy. Do you have any question, doctor, regarding the ectopic pregnancy? Tell me. It. What do you mean SIPs? That is a fluid, simple fluid at least. Doctor, blood, one thing. Your serous fluid, bile and blood cannot be differentiated by ultrasound. But you have to think blood when there is acute pain in the abdomen, when there is any trauma in the abdomen, when there is any heterogeneous mass in the abdomen. So you'll have to think that it's activity to blood, fluid and adequate shunting into blood. Ascites, if there is any spheromegaly and some other fluid, so you'll have to think that is the fluid. If there is any malignancy, then you have to feel like that, doctor. So, by from the history, you have to differentiate with that part, with that blood, by if there is a history of laparoscopic cholecystectomy, and you have to think for bile. Like that, with that history, you have to differentiate blood, bile, and serous spleen. Okay, clear? Fluid, you write fluid in the, you just simply fluid, you write fluid in the coronal space. Suggestive of hemoglobin, like that. Fluid in the hemoglobin space, suggestive of hemoglobin. Say, for example, that they provide the screening region. Provide the screening region. You are suffering this rupture of the screening membrane, rupture of the spleen. And if you get fluid in the peritoneum, that is the hemoglobin space, then you have to say fluid in the hemoglobin space, suggestive of hemoglobin. Like that. So, doctor, one thing, so actually, last week I hope that I could add in the plate, but I could not do it. So, I promise you that on Monday onwards, I'll show you the plate. On Monday onwards, I'll show you the plate. I have some technical problem. For that reason, I could not, on Monday onwards, I'll show you the plate. Okay, doctor? So I made it here. So, I hope all of you understood and give your opinion, doctor. Give your feedback. And because this is a new technique, a new technology, that is the online class. I am not very much acquainted with it, you all know. I am not very much acquainted with it, but I have to do it for my students and because people could not come to our center. For that reason, I have to perform taking the online class. But I am an old man, so I prefer the old fashion taking the class.